The main focus of my speech today was really about how difficult embracing design in business can be, and that really it's not about the design of pretty things anymore, but it's very much about designing change in a business itself. And so I talk quite a lot about the challenges of change, most of which are the kind of normal resistances and fears we have to anything, and particularly how design thinking can help you overcome that, and particularly when you engage it in the boardroom. I was really excited when I heard the theme for today's event, design for business. It's pretty much been a mantra of mine for 20 odd years now. And it's right up there in my mind with war is over, just do it, yes you can, and probably more appropriately for today, keep calm and design on. Four things I'd like to chat to you about this morning. So design for business. First of all, why you should. You wouldn't be here this morning if there wasn't some interest. Then I want to talk about why you can't. Because we all struggle with design and designers and design thinking. I'll share three short stories of three businesses that I've helped on major design transformations, how they did. And I'll end with some practical advice on how you can, what I call my seven habits of highly designful businesses, which hopefully you can take forward with you today. So why you should? The evidence for design in business now is completely, I would say, irrefutable and overwhelming. I mean, here are some of the, I'm only gonna spend one slide on this, but it's quite interesting, you know. We know good design creates value and competitive advantage. We know good design helps command higher prices. We know good design, as Mark mentioned, is associated with market leadership. We know good design connects human insight with business goals, and so it goes on. Warding off commoditization, shaping the future. Good design makes us happier. Makes me really happy to pay a premium for using things that are well thought through and well made. And although good design and the effect of it is notoriously difficult to evaluate, businesses that regularly report return on investment of good design report ROIs of about 15%, which is pretty good in anybody's business. So the bottom line of this is good design is good business. I could end here, but alas, I won't. It's a bit slow. So if the evidence for good design in your businesses is so overwhelming, why do we find it so difficult and so challenging a subject? And I think the key to that is that to really unleash the power of great design in any business, it's not about designing just things anymore and how they look. Is that going to be a bit quicker? Thank you. It's getting beyond the design of what things should be, and it's getting much more stuck into the thorny subject of designing how things should become. And that's a lot of stuff to design. That's designing brands, it's designing identities, communication, designing products. We heard a little bit earlier about processes. I would add tools, teams, policy, systems, methodology, and designing collaborations. Suddenly, the real challenge of unleashing design in your business is not the design of that little bit of packaging or that ad or that product anymore. It's designing a much broader climate and ecosystem where great design work can flourish. And I'm afraid there's an inconvenient truth about change, and you all know it, is that it's hard, really hard, and most change fails. And that's change of any big strategic attempt at change in an organization is doomed in many instances to failure, 70%. And this is researched time and time again, sector by sector, market by market, organizations who try big strategic step changes of any description, 70% of those fail or they fail to meet their expectations. Now, I would argue that when it comes to big design changes in an organization, that figure would be even higher because of the intangibility, because of the kind of human, personal nature of the whole design process itself. So if we want to embrace design, we have to understand how to design change in our organizations. When you look at the 70% of big change initiatives that fail, 75% of the reasons associated with that lack of success are these things: the enemies within. It's not the competition over the street. It's not something happening on the far side of the world. It's these things. Anybody recognize this stuff? These are our enemies within. Say hello to them. Nothing to be afraid of here. It's all human nature. Fear of the unknown, not invented here. Here we go again. Yeah? Too busy to change. It's too little, too late. Lack of support. Poorly managed. Self-interest. I would add to that arrogance and complacency. They are a pretty potent mix as well. Silent assassins. Change that's done to, not with. Internal politics, not joined up. When I look back on my early days of my career, and I think about all the thousands of hours spent working late nights and weekends, eating pizza, coming up with ideas and taking them to clients and organizations, only to find that nothing happened or it didn't go anywhere. And you know what I did? I blamed the client, of course. They didn't get it. They weren't ready. And what I'd never understood back then is this stuff. The resistance to change, and it is natural, and it needs to be understood and embraced with engaging with design in an organization just as much as engaging with any big changes anywhere else. So if we're going to really unleash the full power of design in an organization, we have to understand how we can design change itself into our businesses. So just a few points on that. My how to change in not 8 so easy steps. The interesting here, like any journey, is the first couple of steps are crucial. What do you think the first most important step to take in a successful, big, transformative design change in your business would be? Any cause? First thing, first most important step. Come on. Anybody got one?
To listen.
To listen. Okay. Any others?
Get buy-in.
Get buy-in. Yeah. Any more?
Desire.
The all important, a lot of people would throw into the mix, got to have a vision, got to have some leadership, so on and so forth. Actually, those are the two most important steps in driving a big transformative change around design in your business. The first is creating a sense of urgency. And I don't mean urgency from a desperation point of view that we're going out of business and the business is going to hell in a handcart. Positive urgency, desire, ambition, potential. But it has to be real. If you don't have a compelling sense of urgency, guess what happens the minute another priority comes along? It gets shuffled down the in tray. And the second thing is building a coalition. And for me, this is the most important insight. If I could share with you one thing today, remember this point. It is not about just boardroom buy-in. It is about building a coalition around an organization of a small community of people who are genuinely committed and open to the idea of where a design journey might take you. And often that coalition might involve Jim in operations. And Jim's been there 25 years. And Jim can kill just about any project in your business with a raise of an eyebrow. He's the eyebrow assassin. And at this point, you don't need to understand where the journey's taking you or even what the outcome are, but to build that sense of urgency and to design and build a coalition of acceptance of going on that. If you don't have that around a big design program or indeed any big change initiative, things are likely to unravel. And then the things that I've shared with you that I won't dwell on, then the vision, then communicate, the action, the quick wins, momentum, and company-wide. But what I've realized in working with big step change design programs is that you have to actually design that process and design and build that climate, or things tend to not work. So let me share with you few case studies of organizations that I've helped on similar journeys. I'm not going to talk about Apple or Virgin or Microsoft or the big global brands. I'm going to focus on three short stories from small and medium-sized businesses that I've helped along the way. This is Sansor House in Shropshire, rural estate, been in the family for many generations. Like a lot of real estate, significantly challenged in terms of succession planning for the next generation, in terms of making the basic economics of a real estate business pay. When I started to talk to these chaps, the original thinking was very much, well, we probably need to do a really sexy organic range of pork sausages and sell them in Waitrose, and that'll be the key out of it. And spent quite a lot of time building a very unusual coalition with quite a lot of people who'd lived on the estate for a long time. And out of that emerged a much bolder, almost 20-year vision for Sansor Estates, which was to pioneer the whole idea of modern rural living. Quite a bold, audacious statement for the estate, and was very much not about just looking at themselves, but actually picking up on the zeitgeist of how people are going to live and work in rural economies. From that, there was a whole development of different business models and units that spun out of it, a whole lifestyle piece on Sansor itself. What was quite interesting here is when we actually got into the phone list of who lived on the estate, there were some great writers and some great photographers, bizarrely, who happened to be, so they actually became part of the design team. The kind of things that you would expect, but actually the linchpin of the modern rural living concept, and this was the big ask and this was the big call, was this thing. Because if we really want to pioneer modern rural living at Sansor Estates, we need to create employment and we need to create work. And so there was a major project to create the Sansor Pavilions, which again was probably the most important piece of the jigsaw, not only commercially, but from a positioning point of view, was the creation of this business park. It was opened by the Duke of Westminster and was really, I think, the wake-up call when people realized that this is a estate with a purpose and it's got a commitment around that. And I think those two images pretty much sum up the journey that Sansor went on. The audacity to allow Jim, who'd worked on the estate for 20 years, to he had all of these photographs. He took very strange photographs of pig's tails and acorns and horse manure, actually, really extraordinary things. And they were in his private collection, and he lived there. It was just waiting to be discovered. And I suppose if you would have asked that family at the outset of that process that one day we'll be running ads with Savills for letting units and business parts, it would have been completely unthinkable. That whole journey was a design journey for them, and it was as much about designing succession planning for the children, and indeed the children's children, giving the whole estate a future, as it was the outputs themselves. Next up is a regional brewer in Lancashire, J.W. Lees. Regional, I'm a real ale fanatic. That's nothing to do with not being successful for Man United, but there you go. And this is an industry, regional brewers, in terminal decline long before the recession hit. The government's pressing on one side, the supermarkets are pressing on the other. This was really a massive organizational wake-up call. And one of the interesting things we did here, and again about building the coalition, the need to build the coalition was so strong here that we outed the whole process from day one. So literally on the website at the start of the project, you know, was basically saying, you know, we've decided to face up to the challenges. It was almost having a conversation with its own marketplace, not just internally, but externally. There were two signature cornerstone pieces here. One was the whole organizing idea for this brewery was be yourself. It was no more apology for not being a big multinational. Celebrate individuality, celebrate the community pubs. And that thing there on the left, which was the creative charter, and it's an innocent little document, but it was the most important piece of paper in the whole project. This was back to the coalition. This was getting a whole bunch of people who had, quite rightly, a lot of healthy cynicism to literally sign up for a 3-year commitment to be part of this company-wide transformation. We then set about trying to shape the marketplace up. The grip glass was inspired by the grandfather's hand. Every pint of real ale would be served in a grip glass. We calculated exactly how many of those we would assume would be stolen from the pubs and made sure we overbribed. Always a mark of success. I always remember that with the Quaglino's ashtrays in London. And of course, the grip glass then became a product. We started selling things on a website, unthinkable for a regional brewer, national press, celebrating the community, real people doing real things. Massive refocus around talent and recruitment and starting to attract much higher quality and much more retail-minded people into what was predominantly a manufacturing culture. That whole concept then played out across the whole pub estate. Top left, bottom left there is the reception at the brewery. There wasn't a reception. The idea of people would want to come to the brewery. They would come around the back and deliver things, but the idea of having a reception, and there was a broken down cottage on the brewery site, which is the bottom right image there, which was redeveloped as a training center. And 3 years later, there's the new director of retailing, which didn't exist on the phone list when we started the project, picking up the Entrepreneur of the Year award in 2009. So that's quite a journey for them. And the last one I'll leave you with, any theatre lovers in here? Then the stage will need no introduction. For those of you who aren't theatre lovers, the stage is the weekly paper for the theatrical and entertainment industry. This is how it looked in 1893 when it cost 2p. And that's how it looks in November this year, where it costs a little bit more. But sadly, not enough more. And for 100 years, very little changed with that organization. For the last 18 months, I've been working with them on a pretty radical review of the whole business model, and the drive to move beyond a kind of circulation and classified ad sales model, you know, in the digital era. It needs to move forward. And the whole focus of this is actually on innovating new businesses. We have two in market at the moment, an event business, which was launched about a year ago, and just recently we've launched a dating site, which again would have been pretty unthinkable, called Love Arts. It's a 50-50 revenue share with a partner. And over the next 3 years, we've probably got about 6 to 8 new businesses that are all stage inspired, that are all driven by the same vision and values of the stage, moving into market. Probably with this organization, the design of the climate has been absolutely critical. Before we even put creative pen to paper, the family board has been restructured, the management board has been restructured, the organization has been restructured, 8 key new hires in different disciplines to create the talent and the capability and the climate to rapidly innovate these businesses. So back to the design, the change again. And that was quite a calculated decision. Don't rush into the creative, get the climate right, or it doesn't grow, and you don't grow either. So there's 3 organizations that you might identify with them. They're medium-sized, they were small, they had all of those insecurities, those enemies within. And I think it was really by sitting down and designing the whole transformation and the climate of those organizations that allowed the design work to flourish. Was critical in moving them forward. So how does that apply to your businesses? Well, I try to, it's one of the things I really enjoy about these kind of sessions. It does give me an opportunity, as Mark mentioned, to try and share what I've learned. And I think there are 7 habits that I believe are the ones that I would associate with designful businesses. And it's these things. First of all, they embrace design in the boardroom. And I don't think there's any way of shirking this. You know, I don't mean that means you allow the creatives to come in and pitch the idea. I mean, you embrace design and design thinking as a way of looking at the world, of looking at your business, and looking at creative and commercial problem solving, and not just in a weekend or a workshop or on a word day, as a long-term commitment. This is the way we're going to start thinking about ourselves and our business. Second habit, they design their transformation. If you just assume you're ready for all of this explosion of creativity and innovation, you are very likely, in my humble opinion, to be one of that sad 70% that don't make it. You have to accept that the design of the change itself is arguably one of your most creative challenges. I've always said idea is a four-letter word, which is risk. Bigger the idea, bigger the risk. In this climate, even little risks are bigger risks. And I think that the mentality of seeing creative ideas as risks, to relish taking those risks, to not be afraid of them and to have the capability, if they don't work, kill them off, move on. If they're working a bit, rapidly improve them and prototype them. But that idea of relishing risk-taking, and again, in a lot of the businesses that I just shared with you, that was a real cultural shift because a lot of those businesses hadn't changed literally for 100 years. About 15 years ago, a very good friend of mine called me a pragmatic dreamer, and I got really upset. I thought, he's like, you're just a pragmatic dreamer. I thought that was a put down, and I've come to realize that it was anything but. And I think the ability to ask what if, but how will at the same time is absolutely crucial. We live in a world now where we can't just blue sky forever. We have to be thinking, what if we did that, but how will we do it? And the two things for me are completely connected. It's two halves of the same coin. It's two halves of the same sentence. And again, I think that idea of dream big, but be extremely pragmatic and practical about it at the same time, and do not disconnect those thought processes, absolutely critical. They're really curious and they continuously improve. And I think, you know, I found that that's something that is easy to say, but again, it needs to be nurtured. It's something that needs to be kind of built and infected in organizations. You know, it was really interesting with the Sansa example, where we had a great big session with everybody who lived on the estate and asked them what they were into and why did they live there. And we did a kind of hobbies audit because we were really interested in how people live there. If we hadn't have done the hobbies audit, we wouldn't have found Jim the photographer and you wouldn't be looking at the pigtail. And I think that kind of curiosity often fuels projects. It's not just something that has to be outsourced. This kind of thinking, by the way, is not only something that is the kind of premise of people who have been at design schools. It's a way that everybody can think about the world. They're cross-functional and collaborative. Again, massively important. If you want to look at a business from a more well-rounded perspective, you need that cross-functional and collaborative perspective. And I think actually the most important in all of this is that they see the world through the eyes of others. Now, the obvious way of understanding that comment is that means we put the customer first and that means we're customer-centric. But it's deeper than that. It's seeing the world through the eyes of your colleagues, your shareholders, your partners, your value chain, genuinely pursuing that degree of empathy. Almost think of yourself last. It's a selflessness that I think great design led businesses embrace, and great design-led teams, that's just the way that they think and operate. I'll leave you with a final thought. This is Robin from Sansor, and I thought this was one of the most poignant quotes anybody's ever said to me about going through a big design step change. He said, "We benefited hugely from creative and lateral thinking, mostly outside the box," which of course is a relative. One man's box is another man's cage. What we found so refreshing was the ability to look at ourselves afresh, to develop a philosophy, strategy, and ideas for the business that would take us into the future. And what was really interesting for me at that point is how much they enjoyed looking at themselves afresh. And that, to me, is all about that point. You know, what started off as a very scary, daunting, burning bridge, by the end of that process, because it was well designed, became something that they really enjoyed. They learned. And I think when you transform anything fundamentally you transform yourself in the process. So I suppose in summary, design isn't a destination in itself. It never was and it never will be. But I'm absolutely convinced by the work that I've done over the last 20 years and everything that I see and hear in business now, that design is the way for you to, and design in its fullest sense, the kind of design that we've been talking about this morning, design thinking, organizations that embrace those seven habits, design is the way to build a bolder and brighter business for yourself. So back to my slogan, design for business. Have a good morning. Thank you very much.